From the JAMA Network, this is JAMA Clinical Reviews, interviews and ideas about innovations in medicine, science, and clinical practice.
Welcome to listeners from around the world, and thank you for tuning in to this JAMA Clinical Review podcast. I am your host, Mary McDermott, Deputy Editor of JAMA, and I'm here today with Dr. John Way, who's Professor of Urology at University of Michigan in Ann Arbor, and he is author of a JAMA review on the topic of lower urinary tract symptoms in men. Welcome, Dr. Way.
Thank you for inviting me, Mary. It's my pleasure.
Let's get started. Can you first tell our listeners, what do you mean when you refer to lower urinary tract symptoms?
Well, you know, this is an incredibly common complaint that men will have, particularly as they're getting older. And men will often present with disturbances in the urination. Commonly, they'll say they have weak stream or urinary urgency. And there's a host of other symptoms as well.
And what causes these symptoms?
Well, generally and commonly, we say there are two underlying physiologic problems that can cause lower urinary tract symptoms in men. The first is what everyone hears about, which is enlargement of the prostate or benign prostate hyperplasia. The second, actually less commonly discussed, is an overactive bladder. So either a obstruction due to benign prostate hyperplasia or an overactive bladder due to bladder detrusor dysfunction.
And how common are these symptoms and who is at risk?
They are very common. I like to tell my students that in the primary care setting, some 40% of men aged over 50 are already complaining of urinary symptoms. And those at risk, of course, are those who are getting older. The histologic studies, that is, way back in the day, they did an autopsy study and they looked at men as they got older and they looked at the pathology of the prostate. And men in their 80s, something like 80 or 90% of men in the 80s, histologically, will have BPH already. So getting older is a common problem. There is a small, slight familial slant association, although it's not very strong. And there's also some metabolic syndrome associations, you know, things with diabetes, insulin resistance, hypertension, heart disease.
And earlier you referred to the two main causes, obstruction to urinary flow and overactive detrusor muscle. How does the clinician distinguish between these two?
I would say it's not easy. And in most cases, even we urologists as specialists cannot discern the difference. We know that in men as they get older, both are likely to be in play. One may be more common than the other or more important than the other. What we really manage is the patient's urinary symptoms rather than the diagnosis.
And do the symptoms vary according to the cause?
Yes. Now, it's not strictly like draw a line in this. Two cause and two symptoms, that would be simple, right? What we have is obstructive symptoms tend to be men coming in with urinary hesitancy, that is, takes them a long time to get their urine started, a weak urinary stream. Sometimes they have to void several times to feel empty, or they just don't feel empty when they're done urinating. So these are the obstructive symptoms. I think of the guy at the football games at the urinal, you know, with BPH. The other half, the irritative symptoms, are more commonly associated with bladder problems, and those are urinary urgency, urinary frequency, and getting up at night. Those are probably the three biggest bladder complaints.
And so what diagnostic testing should be performed for patients with these symptoms?
We start with evaluation of the symptoms themselves. The easy thing to do is to measure the symptoms, quantify the symptoms with something like the International Prostate Symptom Score. In my practice, we actually have patients fill it out on an iPad. It goes right to our EMR. And when I see the patient, it's already there. So evaluation of symptoms are important. We typically will look at things like their bladder residual, bladder ultrasound, to see if they're in urinary retention objectively. Other testing that we do, like cystoscopy, checking a PSA if they're in the right age group for prostate cancer screening, those are more depending on the symptoms that the patients have, whether or not they will have more testing like that.
So in the primary care, when a patient presents with some of these symptoms, what should the primary care physician do? Like who should be referred for cystoscopy, for example?
So I think it's quite all right to start management based on the patient's urinary symptoms, start medical management. Not a whole lot of evaluation needs to be done by primary care. The one thing I would recommend is examine the patient, feel for the bladder. About once or twice a year, I'll see a patient with symptoms and they have a palpable bladder. You know, they have a liter of urine in the bladder. That's probably the most important thing. Make sure your patient's not in retention.
Should you check a urinalysis in primary care or should you do a prostate exam?
Yeah, so ruling out a urinary infection, because even though men tend to get fewer UTIs than women, I think is a good thing to do. You dip the urine, make sure it's not an obvious urinary tract infection. We don't typically see patients for cystoscopy just because they have urinary symptoms. That's not necessary to do cystoscopy. But if patient also has hematuria, you dip the urine, they have microscopic hematuria, yes, then you refer them for cystoscopy.
Okay. So let's say I have a patient in my practice with lower urinary tract symptoms, and their urinalysis is normal, and they don't have a palpable bladder. What should I recommend?
Well, typically, we'll start with pharmacologic management. And there's a whole host of pharmacologic things that we can offer these days. Commonly used, just because it's fast-acting, is alpha blockade, something like tamsulosin. Because you can tell your patient, well, in a week or two, you should notice an improvement in your symptoms. And if you don't notice it by 2 weeks, or if you have side effects, then just stop it. It's actually very user-friendly.
And are the treatments differing according to whether one suspects more of an obstructive problem versus an overactive detrusor muscle problem?
Yeah, and this is one of the newer modalities that we have, is basically thinking of this lower urinary tract symptoms, not just as BPH, but really as a bladder problem. So if a patient comes in, and I like to ask patients, of the urinary symptoms you have, what bothers you the most? If you can only say one thing, what is it? And if the patient says, it's my frequency, or it's urinary urgency, I have to know where every bathroom is on my way to the supermarket, I'll actually offer them a medication for the bladder before even prostate medication like tamsulosin.
Oh, and what would that be?
Well, there is two classes approved for overactive bladder. One is the old anticholinergic class of medications, and the other one is beta-3 agonist, which is a sympathetic agonist that's maybe on the market now somewhere 5 years, 10 years, something like that.
Okay. So if we go back to the patient with the tamsulosin, let's say they don't respond, what would you do next for that patient?
It's almost like asking me what day of the week, what medication I would go to next, because there is no guidelines. You have to go from A to B, right? So I go back and I always ask what bothers the patient most. If it's something like slow stream, I might do something like tadalafil, which is a PDE inhibitor approved for BPH, or use something like finasteride or dutasteride, which are the phosphodiesterase inhibitors that shrink the prostate. If the patient, on the other hand, had chief complaint of urgency frequency or getting up at night, I would try adding in or switching from one class anticholinergic to beta-3 agonist or vice versa.
And do you combine treatments ever?
Oh, yes. This is one of the newer approaches now, is to combine. And it's like cooking. You could almost combine any of these classes because they would work synergistically.
And then is it fair to say if a patient doesn't respond to one class, it's reasonable to try a drug in another class?
Yes, absolutely. Yeah. I would not try the same class. Like an alpha blocker will have similar efficacy. The only reason to change within a family is because of, say, side effects.
Okay. Can we talk about those side effects? Like, what are considerations when you're trying to select an initial therapy on side effects?
So a common thing that I'll see in aging men is they also have ED. So when I'm thinking about the first medication to start someone and they already have ED and they have urinary symptoms, something like tadalafil actually is very nice because it will treat both problems.
Your review mentions cataracts as a consideration.
For alpha blockers.
Yes. Can you talk about that?
Yeah. A problem which got a lot of press, 20 years ago, was it was noted that tamsulosin, even taken with a single dose, resulted in something called floppy iris syndrome. This is a problem only if patients are undergoing cataract surgery, where literally the iris doesn't have the rigidity that the ophthalmologists are used to. Nowadays, they are all aware of it. They know how to manage it. So it's much less of a problem. Clinically, what I do is I ask patients, do they have cataracts? Are they expecting cataract surgery? And if the answer is yes, I avoid alpha blockers.
And then what about concern about cognition, some of the anticholinergics?
Yeah, this is emerging data, far from certain. But particularly in older patients, it's been found in both men and women that anticholinergics seem to increase the risk of cognitive decline. They don't have it down narrowed to exactly which population, but certainly patients who already have risk, for instance, Parkinson's disease or other neurodegenerative type of disease, I would stay away from anticholinergics.
Can you just comment? I mean, this is a huge issue. How strong is the evidence?
It's emerging, is how I would say. There's data going back and forth. but it gained a lot of press in our field starting probably 5 years ago. It's still approved, interestingly. It hasn't gotten part of FDA reviewing it, so they're still approved for use.
Okay. Can we talk for a moment about behavioral interventions and when those should be used?
Yeah, I typically always start with behavioral interventions because they're easy, right? And a common thing is fluid restriction. We see patients and they're drinking 2 liters of fluid a day. They drink a lot of fluids, glass of milk before they go to bed, and they're complaining about getting up at night. You know, so I explain what goes in has to come out, and reasonable fluid restriction without going to the point of dehydration is a simple thing to do. Other lifestyle behavioral things that they can do is avoid caffeine or reduce caffeine, known to have a diuretic effect, known to be a stimulant for bladder, leading to symptoms of overactive bladder. And of course, what goes in a big Starbucks cup has to come out. So the volume is also there.
Is there a role for physical therapy to strengthen the pelvic floor?
Yes, but it's less of pelvic floor physical therapy to strengthen the pelvic floor as to help relax the pelvic floor. It's the opposite. And physical therapy actually do a lot of things, right? So what you want them to do is if the bladder is overactive and let's say they're washing the dishes and they feel strong urge, they actually train the patients to take a step back, relax your pelvic floor until the sensation goes away, and then they can go back to their activity, for instance, washing dishes. And these therapies have been very effective, more effective than watchful waiting, the do-nothing approach, so no cost, no side effects, and in some studies, as good as starting medications.
Great. Let's move on. What about minimally invasive surgery? Who is a candidate for that, and when would you recommend it?
Technically, anybody with symptoms would be considered for minimally invasive surgery or even surgery. The way I tend to think about management is you start with things that are low risk, behavioral therapy, then pharmacologic therapy, because if you have a complication from minimally invasive surgery or surgery, you can't undo it. So really, the most common group for minimally invasive surgery turns out to be patients who failed behavioral and medical therapy with pharmacologics.
And what does that surgery consist of?
There are numerous treatments. This class are the ones that are either office-based or require minimal sedation in the operating room or procedure area. There is water vapor therapy, where we inject steam into the prostate endoscopically with a cystoscope. There is urolift, where we put these sutures inside the prostate to lift up the lateral lobes of the prostate. And there is this procedure where we put in what looks like a mesh-like device inside the prostate to actually open up the prostate. It's a temporary implant that's removed a week later called iTind.
And then you also mentioned surgical treatment. When is that used?
It can be used when medical therapy fails. It can be used when minimally invasive surgery fails. In rare cases, it's used as a first-line therapy. More often than not, it is the sort of gold standard for resolving bladder outlet obstruction. Both the minimally invasive surgery and the surgery are only treating one of two problems. It's treating the obstruction from the BPH. It does not treat directly an overactive bladder.
Oh, interesting. So is there any kind of diagnostic testing you do before either of those surgeries to make sure that you're treating the right thing?
Yeah, so urologists will often at that point do a cystoscopy, take a look inside. They want to see what the anatomy looks like. They want to make sure there's no bladder stones, which can happen in men. Be aware of it. Make sure there's no bladder tumors. Others may measure the prostate because particularly for the minimally invasive therapy, you either have to do a cystoscopy or measure the size of the prostate somehow. The FDA has approvals for size ranges of the prostate for doing the minimally invasive procedures. And some surgeries, if the prostate is too large, can be dangerous or difficult to conduct.
So it sounds like until you get to surgery, the treatments are really based on symptoms more than etiology.
Absolutely.
So can we just go back for a moment to the symptom score that you typically use? Can you tell us the name of the score, the range, and what constitutes a significant score?
Yeah, most in practice use what's called the International Prostate Symptom Score. Some people call it the AUA, which is our National Society Symptom Score. It consists of 7 items, and they're actually subscores, these 7 items. 4 of them are obstructive symptoms, 3 of them are irritative symptoms, okay? But when combined, you get a score between 0 and 35. It's a Likert scale from 0 to 7 for each item. You add it up, it's real simple to use. More symptoms means a higher score. And when your patients improve, the numbers come down. It's almost like a thermometer, it's very easy to use. a significant change in the score is more than 3 points. Okay, so if you go from score of 25 and go down to 20, that's a significant improvement.
Is there a threshold that you use to determine if someone has significant symptoms?
Not really. It's not that simple. And I'll give you the following scenario. There is an eighth item on this IPSS, which is a satisfaction score. And it asks the patients, if you spend the rest of your life with the symptoms you currently have, how would you feel? And it goes from extremely satisfied, I think, all the way to terrible. Okay, there's a six score. So if a patient has moderate symptoms, but they feel terrible, I'm inclined to offer them treatment. Makes sense, okay? Patient may have just the opposite. They may have a lot of symptoms, but they feel mostly satisfied. Maybe it's that gentleman that never leaves the house and it's not a problem. Why give him a medication if he's okay?
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. Wonderful. I'm Mary McDermott, and I've been speaking today with Dr. John Way about his JAMA review on the topic of lower urinary tract symptoms in men. You can find a link to the article in this episode's description. This episode was produced by Daniel Musisi and Daniel Morrow at the JAMA Network. To follow this and other JAMA Network podcasts, please visit us online at jamanetworkaudio.com or search for JAMA Network wherever you get your podcasts.
This content is protected by copyright by the American Medical Association with all rights reserved, including those for text and data mining, AI training, and similar technologies.